Good evening, sports fans. My name is Jennifer Hausler. I'm assistant director of 92Y Talks, and we are so very proud to be presenting this event with basketball superstar Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. A special welcome to all of you joining us by webcast tonight. If this is your first time here, a special welcome to you, and if you've been here before, we welcome you back. There is no place like the 92nd Street Y. In the words of President Bill Clinton, this is the place where people go to find out what's really going on. News events are always being added, and you can go to our website at 92y.org and sign up for our e-news, and you'll be the first to know about them. There will be time for your questions tonight. You should submit them on the cards that you've been given. They'll be collected by the ushers and brought to the stage. After the program, Mr. Abdul-Jabbar will be signing copies of his book in the lounge adjacent to the hall. The book is called Sasquatch in the Paint. And now I'd like to introduce Bud Mishkin, a wonderful friend and frequent moderator here at 92Y. Bud has worked in radio and television news and sports since graduating from the University of Pennsylvania. He's one of New York One's original employees, dating back to the station's inception in 1992. And he's been the host of New York One's weekly series, One-on-One with Bud Mishkin, profiling more than 250 influential and intriguing New Yorkers. He's interviewed practically as many people here on our stage. Please welcome Bud Mishkin.
Thank you. We love our athletes. We admire what they do on the field of play. We cheer when the home team wins. When it doesn't, we do something else. And if we are truly sophisticated fans, we respect any player on any team who raises the game to an art form. And occasionally, we come across the athlete whose worldview extends beyond the field of play. The athlete who understands that while the game is important, it is indeed only a game. Kareem Abdul-Jabbar is the NBA's all-time leading scorer. His high school, Power Memorial, here in Manhattan, won 71 straight games. He won three straight NCAA titles with UCLA in the late 60s. He won a championship with the Milwaukee Bucks in 1971 and five more with the Lakers. He was a six-time MVP, and he is a member of the Basketball Hall of Fame. But his post-NBA career is easily as compelling. He is the author of several books, including the most recent, right here, Sasquatch in the Paint, a story that every young athlete, in fact, every young person who has any aspirations should read. His works include Brothers in Arms, the epic story of the 761st Tank Battalion, World War II's Forgotten Heroes, and On the Shoulders of Giants, My Journey Through the Harlem Renaissance. He was the executive producer of a documentary of the same name in 2011. As if that were not enough, there was, of course, his memorable turn as Roger Murdoch in the classic Airplane. It's been quite a journey. And best of all, it all started here. Please welcome home Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. Welcome back to New York.
Thank you very much.
And congratulations on the book, which is terrific. How much of Sasquatch is you?
Well, it's kind of loosely based on some of the experiences I had as an adolescent, especially talking about someone who had a growth spurt and everybody expected him to be a great basketball player, but he actually didn't possess any skills. And being kind of nerdy, I made the honor roll. Every grading period from the fifth grade on. Fortunately, my dad had taught me how to box, so I didn't get picked on too much. But yeah, so a lot of it reflects the things that I experienced as I was growing up and trying to learn the game and trying to figure out what to do with my life.
So this may sound like an unusual question to one of the greatest basketball players of all time, but were there moments early on where you doubted, can I do it or not?
Most of those moments were full of doubt. I was just, when I started high school, I was just hoping that I would get a scholarship to college. So I could further my education and not have to pay for it. And I didn't know how good I was going to be.
You know, I read some of the basketball facts that I just read. Pretty good for a baseball guy, right?
Yeah,
because you were indeed a baseball guy, right?
I wanted to play baseball. I rooted for Brooklyn.
I believe that's allowable here.
Yeah, it is. It better be. Yeah. But, you know, I lived up near the Polo Grounds, so it was enemy territory. And if I put my cap on, I either had to fight or run. But actually, those were good times.
So is there, you talk about moments of doubt. Are there, as you start to play more, is it a good feel, a good balance in terms of, we always talk about the ideal of balancing academics and athletics. Did you find that at Power Memorial, or was that a struggle?
No, it wasn't a struggle. And Power Memorial is a pretty demanding school academically. They did not have any like general diplomas. You couldn't take shop or anything like that.
Right.
They only had academic subjects and pretty intense schedule, foreign languages, all of that stuff. I got a good education there.
In the book, you write about the character Sasquatch, and he starts to play with players who are better, and he starts to get involved in that world and try to bridge the world of his love of science and his growing love of basketball. Was there a place for you where you started to learn, okay, this is how the game is played, either in school or on the playgrounds?
Well, it was on the playgrounds. I played in my neighborhood in Inwood, and I also played in Harlem. That was definitely a step up. The game is very seriously considered in Harlem. I found that out the hard way. And
Such as
going down there and getting beat on, and you just had to deal with it and figure out a way to cope. But there's nobody there to rescue. People are just waiting for you to either cope or get your butt kicked. That's how it goes down.
Your dad went to Juilliard.
Yes, he did.
And so my question, and your love of music, especially jazz, is well known and has been written about extensively. Was there any point when you were in school where you considered that music would be your future?
Very early, while I was still in grade school, I had piano lessons, but I didn't want to practice.
That's so funny because I've not heard that from...
probably heard it from everybody who's had
exactly.
piano lessons. I didn't want to practice, and I wanted to play baseball, and my mom enrolled me in Little League. I was the happiest kid in Manhattan, and so that was it. I was hoping I could replace, at some point I could replace Gil Hodges playing first base for the Brooklyn Dodgers.
Mm-hmm. And is there a moment that you recall where, or maybe is it gradual, where it kind of dawns on you, that might not be happening?
Yeah. I eventually ended up pitching in seventh and eighth grade, which was after Little League.
Mm-hmm.
And I could throw the ball hard, but there were really questions as to where the ball would go very often. And a lot of the parents of the kids that I pitched against, they would start screaming, he's too old. I was, you know, over 6 feet tall.
Right.
And where's his birth certificate? save my boy, he's going to kill him. So I realized that basketball was probably the best path, and I stuck with that.
Along the way, I've read that you were part of a journalism program when you were in high school.
Yes, I was. Between my junior and senior year in high school, I was in a program called Haru Act. It was a poverty program in Harlem, and the whole challenge given to the participants was what can you do to make Harlem a better place?
Uh-huh.
And they had a number of different workshops, music, drama, dance, community work, photography. There was artists. I was in a journalism workshop. We put out a weekly newsletter about Harlem. And in doing that, it really helped me find what I wanted to do because I enjoyed writing. I had probably, of all the kids participating in the journalism workshop, I was the one who was most adept at punctuation and sentence structure, so I also was the editor. So that was a lot of fun, and it opened up the world of writing in a very serious way for me, and I enjoyed it, and it's something that I always wanted to pursue from that point on.
As you're in the middle of your NBA career, obviously a tremendous amount of success, but is there kind of some longing for when the career is over, then I can dedicate that much more time to writing and to creating these books which you have created?
That's how it worked out. I did an autobiography called Giant Steps in 1984, and it was pretty well received. And then after my career was over, I did a journal of my last year in professional basketball. Mm-hmm. And at that point, writing about me was tired. The next book I did was a history book called Black Profiles in Courage. And got good reviews, made the New York Times bestseller list, and I was on my way as an author at that point.
The book about the African-American unit in World War II.
Yes.
And then the book about the Harlem Renaissance, part of which was the Harlem Wrens, and then the documentary. You were a history major at UCLA.
Yes.
So this must have just seemed like, oh, this is perfect. This is kind of combining all these things that I love to do.
Yeah, everything seemed to dovetail in all of that. And I really enjoyed that. And it really was a labor of love because I didn't find out in depth about who the Harlem Wrens actually were until I started doing the research for that book.
This is a basketball team that, it's funny, the irony, of course, is the Harlem Globetrotters were not from Harlem.
Right.
Or the Harlem Wrens, short for the Renaissance, they were actually emblematic of Harlem at that time.
That's Harlem teams. The Harlem Globetrotters are from Chicago.
Right.
For those of you who don't know, most people make that. I made that assumption for most of my life until I found out.
Well, it's always intrigued me in covering sports and dealing with athletes and former athletes that the whole notion of when the cheering stops is a really interesting human story, not just an athletic story, but a human story in terms of how does one transfer. And we're seeing it in New York these days with the great Yankees, Andy Pettit retiring, Mariano Rivera retiring. Many of us, most of us, will never know what it's like to be cheered by thousands, and then all of a sudden, that's gone.
Right.
So it seems pretty clear that you were prepared for that and had things to do and ready to go. In dealing with your colleagues, teammates, opponents, did you get some sense that most were ready for it, or that this was kind of an unknown that was incredibly fearful to players?
Very few players prepare for it. And Jackie Robinson said something very profound on that subject. He said that athletes die twice, because that first death is the end of your professional career when you can't play this game that really, it's a boys' game.
Right.
You can't do it anymore, and you have to figure out another way to have a meaningful life.
When you started doing the books, especially when you started on topics beyond yourself, did you have to kind of get past when you're interviewing people and doing research, all they want to talk about is the Lakers and UCLA, or were they pretty quickly onto the topic of, okay, he's doing a serious book about this subject here, so let's just take it from there?
Most of them reacted to the subject matter.
Yeah.
In fact, my fame as an athlete really helped me get into some doors that might have been a lot more difficult to get into just because they knew about me as an athlete. So it's not always a negative.
And just as I asked about early doubts in terms of basketball, how about in terms of being a writer? Especially early on when you're doing the first couple of books. Is there some sense of, no, I have a facility for this?
No, you know, I actually had an experience at UCLA. I had two majors at UCLA, English and history. Mm-hmm. And I was taking this one history class, English class, excuse me, and at one point after the midterms, teacher said he was going to read the best essays, and I picked the three best essays, and he read them to the class, and I was just waiting to get out of there. I wanted to get up and leave, but I couldn't do that. And then finally, the last one, he said, this is the best one, and it was my essay. And at that, that was really a very important moment for me, because I was realized at that point that, you know, maybe I could write, you know, because this was an English class. This was not somebody blowing smoke. I actually earned that status, and it felt good, and it's something that I wanted to revisit. And mm-hmm. I just had to wait 20 years, but I finally got to do it again.
You had some things going on in the interim that were taking up a bit of your time.
A few things in Los Angeles and Milwaukee there.
Back to Sasquatch and the Pain. In terms of putting things in from your own life or things that are influenced by your own life, is it kind of a balancing act in terms of I want to put some stuff in, but not too much so that it's just people read it and just think that, oh, he had that happen to him and he had that happen to him?
Well, very fortunately for me, my co-author, Raymond Otsfeld, mm-hmm. he has two kids that are in middle school. So he took a lot of what he knew from just what he's dealing with right now, daily with his kids, mm-hmm. and mixed it in with a lot of the elements that that I wrote about. And we were able to blend them together. And the book takes place in Orange County. And people don't realize it's a very diverse place. Mm-hmm. And the diversity is comparable to that of New York City. And it's very hard to believe, because you think of California as being rather homogenous. Mm-hmm. But it's a very diverse place. And all of it seemed to blend together pretty well.
And we think of Orange County as particularly homogenous. So the notion that it is a pretty diverse place, is actually, I think, is quite surprising.
Yeah, it would.
Yeah. There are so many topics, and we'll get to a couple of the NBA topics and a couple of the other books that you've written. This is going to be an understatement of the night. The year 1968 is such an incredible year in American history.
Yes, it was.
And one of the privileges I've had as an interviewer is to be able to interview both John Carlos and Tommy Smith in that iconic moment of the 1968 Olympics with the salute. They only had one pair of gloves at the Olympics. That's why you have one guy with his right hand in the air and one guy with his left hand in the air. In any case, they suffered mightily for that act. Can you tell us a little bit about the lead up to the discussions about possibly boycotting the Olympics? And you did boycott those Olympics. Why certain people boycotted, why certain people went, and how that went down?
Well, formally, there was no boycott.
Right.
You know, it really petered out. But Dr. Harry Edwards, who was a sociologist, he taught in the Bay Area in California, and he's the one who felt that black athletes should boycott the Olympics because of what was going on here in America. It was right at the culmination, really, of the Civil Rights Movement. The Voting Rights Act and the Civil Rights Act had just been enacted, and there was a lot of turmoil. And also all the turmoil over Vietnam. Mm-hmm. Dr. King had been assassinated. Bobby Kennedy had been assassinated. And a whole lot, there was Kent State mm-hmm. that also happened that year. It's a whole lot of things that really portrayed a nation in turmoil. So there was a lot going on. But the boycott really didn't take place. I didn't go because I had a really good job that enabled me to make enough money where I could buy gas for my car and pay for my apartment while I finished my senior year at UCLA. Hmm. That was really why I didn't go. It had nothing to do with participating in the Olympics. But I really had a lot of respect and appreciation for what Carlos and Tommy Smith did, because a statement had to be made about what was happening.
A couple of years prior to that, you had come out in support of Muhammad Ali.
Yes.
You were already at UCLA at that point.
Yes, right? Yes, okay. I was.
Anybody at school or in the basketball program say to you, what are you doing?
No. Coach Wooden actually was very curious about that. Mm-hmm. And he understood how bad things were. Coach Wooden was from a part of Indiana where the Klan had been very active when he was a child and adolescent in southern Indiana. Some pretty ugly things happened there, mm-hmm. and he understood just what violent racism, how negative it could be. And I found out later on, doing the research on the Wrens, that Coach Wooden had played against the Wrens and had a great appreciation for a number of athletes. There was a player for the Wrens who played both for them and for the Black Yankees, which was the Negro League team that played at Yankee Stadium when the regular Yankees didn't play.
Right.
And Coach Wooden was a big baseball fan, too. So he knew this guy. His name was Fats Jenkins. He played against him, and he really understood a lot of what the issues were for Black Americans. He wasn't ignorant in that sense.
You had a chance to talk to Coach Wooden about the Wrens?
No. Well, yeah, while I was doing the research for the book.
That must have just been, talk about, like, you know, connecting some synapses there. Here's a guy who is obviously associated with your career and important to you, not just as a coach, but as a man.
Yes.
And taking the subject that you are falling in love with, I would imagine, and all of a sudden you find out, oh my gosh, he has something to say about it.
And he had something to say about it, and I found out that Langston Hughes is one of his favorite poets.
Right.
Coach Wooden really liked poetry, and some of the stories are really great because Coach Wooden is known as a very straight-laced guy. You know, he's very religious.
Right.
He's not the type of person that you think would be partying or anything like that. Mm-hmm. And he talked about he played against the Globetrotters in Chicago at the Savoy Ballroom in Chicago. That's where the Globetrotters played, and he said, usually he'd go to the train station and go back to Indianapolis after the game, but he said the food was really good, and Cab Calloway's band was there that night. So he stayed in Chicago at the Savoy, and you know, just the whole idea of Coach Wooden partying on the south side of Chicago with Black people and Cab Calloway going "Heidi Ho," that is not how I would think of Coach Wooden.
Yeah.
So it really rounded out my perception of him. It really got a lot broader.
Where is the cell phone camera when you need it in those days, right?
Yeah, I wish I could have seen that.
That would have
been
good.
There. Yeah.
There are thousands and thousands of games through a great career. I want to ask you about three. In 1968, I'm 9 years old, and I don't think you can really, if you're a college basketball fan right now, I don't think you can really get appreciation for the fact that there's not a game on every single night of the week, which seems like it's the norm now. The game against Houston and the Houston Astrodome had this image, or had this feeling of it being like almost like a title fight. And it was a regular season game.
Yes.
You guys would eventually play, and you'd beat them in the tournament that year. Are there particular moments that you recall, not necessarily from the game, but from the experience, that don't make it into the history books about that particular game, 1968, that if you're asked about it, as I am now, or if you think about it, it's like a little anecdote behind the scenes?
For me, it was strange playing a game in a baseball stadium. And the court was out by second base, and the stands were a good 30 or 40 yards away, but the whole arena was full, the stadium was full, but it was like we were playing out on a prairie someplace. And off the end of the court, there was just nothing. It went to the outfield wall and to the home base area and dugout. That's all you saw. And then there were all these people in there. It was the strangest physical atmosphere I'd ever played a game in.
Now, it sounds funny, but all joking aside, does it affect the shooters in terms of depth perception?
My depth perception was affected because I had gotten an eye injury 2 weeks earlier in a game against the University of California. So I had spent 10 days in the eye clinic at UCLA, and I didn't have any chance to practice or stay in shape. So that was the worst game I played in my college career. It's the only game that I shot less than 50% from the field.
And great, here you go. 50 years later, some guy's asking you on the stage about it in New York. You got like 900 championships, and so.
No, but that was a very important game for college basketball because it's felt that game is the game that made the networks realize that college basketball was very popular and was something that would work on television.
Right. Years later, 1985, you win the championship in Boston. And for all those Laker teams prior to you that did not beat the Celtics, this was held out as this momentous occasion. Again, any little moment there, aside from the absolute joy, I would imagine, of winning a championship, that kind of stands out.
Well, for me, it was special because the very first game, we got killed. We lost by about 30 points. They called the game the Memorial Day Massacre, and I had a terrible game. And for me, I just wanted a chance to redeem myself. So game two, I came out and had a really great game, and for the next five games, actually, I played very well, and we won the series in six games, winning the final game in Boston Garden. We're the only team, other than the Boston Celtics, to win a world championship in Boston Garden, and you know I can take that with me to the grave. It will taste good the whole time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I interviewed Jerry West at the 92nd Street Y a couple of years ago, and I had met him, and I had been at a dinner party with him, and one of the greats of all time, a great Laker, but his fortunes against the Celtics were not quite as good, and I had read that he did not allow, when he was playing, did not allow his children to wear any clothing with the color green. did it go that far for you?
No, it didn't go that far for me. And when I was in high school, I rooted for the Celtics. I rooted for Bill Russell Celtics.
I'm sure.
He was a great role model for me, and I watched him play and learned a lot of how to play the game just from going to Madison Square Garden and watching the Celtics play. They used to have double headers at Madison Square Garden.
This is the old Garden.
The old Garden, yeah. Right. So the Celtics would play in New York maybe six or eight times, given that they would play the Knicks three times.
Right.
And then they might play three additional games against other opponents at Madison Square Garden, and I never missed those games.
You were already at Power at the time?
I was at Power, and it was really great for us going to school at Power because our coach knew the people that ran the Garden,
right,
the basketball people there, and he allowed the NBA teams to come and practice at my high school gym. It was only 12 blocks from the Garden.
Yeah.
We were on 61st Street. Garden was on 49th Street. So because of that, all of our names were on a pass list at the Garden, and we could go and sit in the empty seats, and there were a lot of empty seats in the Garden in those days.
Right.
They were terrible. The only people that came to the game were the guys that gambled on the game.
Right. And this is before Willis and Clyde and Barnett and Bradley.
Exactly. Yeah. So I got to go to a lot of games at the Garden and learned how to play the game. And see the best play. So I watched Bill Russell and I watched Wilt and picked up a lot of pointers and incorporated it into my game.
Is there already a sense at that point of people paying attention to you? Or even if you're coming in to be a spectator, like guys looking, that's the kid from Power Memorial.
Yeah, that happened right after my sophomore year in high school. I was consensus All-American. And we were on the Ed Sullivan Show. Ed Sullivan.
Now we're getting somewhere.
Yeah, now we're getting somewhere. Ed Sullivan used to have the parade high school All-American team come on his show, you know, often. And so I was on there in 1963. And I think I still have the pictures that my dad took. He took pictures of our television with me on it. he's that proud of, you know, what I'd done.
Again, if you're, you know, say in your 20s or 30s, and have, you know, you can watch hundreds of channels, the notion of this one show, Ed Sullivan, on Sunday night, this is pretty much it.
Right, it was a variety show, and they tried to cover everything.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. You have a good line, a lot of nice lines in the book, but there's a good passage about you and the character Sasquatch and his best friend are talking about being 13.
His name's Theo.
Right. Being 13, and how, you know, that's kind of an age where parents are looking at the 13-year-old and saying, well, you're no longer a child, and giving it kind of the 13-year-old responsibilities that maybe the 13-year-old is not ready for. It's really beautifully written. My question is, when the attention starts to come to you in high school, is it like, I'm a high school student, what are you doing? Or is there any way to prepare for people who do not know you at all already making judgments about you?
There's no way to prepare for it, but any kid will react to that positively because it's positive attention. People expect good things from you. Mm-hmm. I remember a couple of the Knicks, Willie Nauls and Richie Guerin. I'd see them, you know, they'd acknowledge me. I'm 14, 15 years old, and these guys are playing for the Knicks, and they're acknowledging me, they just say, hey, how you doing? Take a moment to talk to me. But it really encouraged me and gave me an incentive to think that, you know, maybe I might make it. And that was very important to me.
Which leads me to my third game. Somehow, when I was playing basketball in 1972 as a 13-year-old in Monroe, New York, somehow Willis and Clyde didn't get up there to see my game and tell me those sentiments, shockingly. But in any case, the Knicks at that point, home games, except for a rare few, you listened on the radio, which is why Marv Albert, to be perfectly honest, is so important to my generation, because you listen to him every night, be it the Knicks or the Rangers, on the radio. The radio is a whole different thing from television. It's a really personal thing. And, sorry to bring it up, but on November 18th at the Garden, 1972, the Knicks score the last 19 points of the game and beat the Bucks, your team at the time, by 1 point in this amazing game in a season in which they would eventually go on to win the championship a couple of years after the Bucks had won the championship. Anything that, aside from the 19 points, that comes to mind from that game?
Just disappointment. You know, we should have won that game. We understood that we were not able to get any offense going in the last part of the game. Disappointment. But when you are playing in the NBA, you play 82 games. You don't live and die over one game.
Then players will always say that, and understandably, don't get too high, don't get too low. Is that something that is learned, either through someone saying to you, no, you cannot get too down about this or get too excited about this, or do you really have to kind of go through that in a first year in which you're playing many more games than in the college game?
Actually, that lesson was driven home in my case by Coach Wooden.
Right.
That was one thing that he said. He said, perfection is a very hard thing to achieve. He was telling us that, I remember my sophomore year, perfection is a hard thing to achieve, and we were 30-0 that year. So, you know, we started questioning that, and our swagger really increased, and then we lost the game the next year to the University of Houston, but, you know, there were reasons for that, you know, my eye injury and playing an away game, That lesson, I'd learned that lesson. So for me personally, it's not something that, I went to sleep every night thinking about that game against the Knicks.
Right. You know?
But afterwards, I always enjoyed, especially when I got with the Lakers, the Knicks very rarely beat us. We won a lot of games in Madison Square Garden, and I enjoyed those very much.
Don't remember those. The notion that basketball was what you did, but it's not who you are. I've read you in interviews where you say that quite often, and that's a very compelling, to me, very compelling topic. Again, is that something that starts to dawn on you as a high school player or a college player? A pro player? Is there one point or a period in your career where you start to feel that?
We've been talking about this man all night, John Wooden. That was something that he tried to get us to understand, that what we were doing there at UCLA, it wasn't going to last forever, and we better prepare for some other things.
Right.
That was a lesson that he wanted us to understand in the midst of We lost two games my whole college career, but he was teaching us that was the important thing for us to learn. So I felt that Coach Wooden really people don't appreciate how profound he was, and he's a very simple guy, but he understood a lot of things about human nature, and just his whole spiritual side was a part of what he imparted to us.
So when you see now, and I'm not going to paint a broad brush like every program is this way, of course not, it's wrong to do that in anything, but when you see so many instances apparently where the balance between academics and athletics is not going well at, so not even, they don't call them schools anymore, big time college programs, does it make you wonder why more schools cannot have it like you had it, or does it make you consider that, wow, we really had something special?
We really had something special, and college sports, the nature of it has changed tremendously.
Right.
The public perception of college sports is that it's like an extension of high school. Right. You know, where the, like those movies in the 1930s and 40s, where the there's a romance between the quarterback and one of the cheerleaders, right. And they celebrate the victory over their arch rivals at a malt shop someplace. That's not college sports. It's a big business. It's
right.
A $6 billion a year business. And the whole change in the nature of college sports has really changed the product. So you don't see very many student athletes. When is the next time we're going to see someone like Bill Bradley, who was a Rhodes Scholar and an All-American basketball player? I don't think we'll ever see one again.
Delay going into the NBA a couple of years so he could be a Rhodes Scholar.
Yes.
Yeah.
And that was important to him, his education, and that part of his life was very important to him. And that's not the case anymore. It's unusual now to see someone who's a very good basketball player stay in school for 4 years,
right.
And come out and then go play in the NBA. And I think we've lost something there.
We will get to your questions in just a couple of minutes. A few minutes now on one of your other loves, jazz. You just told me backstage you had in high school one of the great jobs as a lover of jazz. One of the great jobs of all time.
Yes,
which
I did.
Somehow in the history books does not get written up. This is shocking. Can you tell us what that job was?
Well, I made a little bit of money. I babysitted for Thelonious Monk's drummer. So when his name is Ben Riley. Ben still lives out in Long Island now. And when Ben's wife would come home about 9:30, 10 o'clock, I could go down to the Village Vanguard and see the Thelonious Monk Quartet play. And I'd stay down there till 2 in the morning listening to Thelonious. It was an incredible experience and something, it's a part of me, a very special part of me.
Your dad went to Juilliard.
Yes.
What kind of player was he?
My dad played trombone. He was not going to be a great soloist, but he would have been a good section man. My dad's dream was to play in Count Basie's trombone section. If he could have done that, he would have died a happy man. He just never got the opportunity.
So at home, is there a, come here, sit down, listen to this, you have to listen to this, or is it more fluid than that?
No, I wanted to listen to it. And from the time, probably when I was in the womb, my parents had a lot of records. My dad always got the latest in records. So. From the time I was just a little boy, I was listening to Sarah Vaughan and Billy Eckstein and Count Basie and Duke Ellington, Nat King Cole, Louis Armstrong. It was the soundtrack in my home.
Mm-hmm.
And it was very special to me. And I remember sometimes I would have, before I'd go to bed, I'd get my mom to play Louis Armstrong's Sleepy Time Down South. You know, it's a special song for me.
We think of rap and hip-hop as the music of the NBA right now in terms of players and music that's played at the arena and maybe the music that players are listening to as they're traveling. I would imagine you listen to jazz during your many travels throughout the NBA.
Yes, I did.
And how'd that go over with your teammates?
Some of my teammates like jazz. James Worthy, he was a jazz fan. Norm Nixon liked jazz. Jamal Wilkes. They were close enough to my generation to have an appreciation for jazz. Very few players in the NBA now know anything about it.
Right. You had an amazing collection, and then you went through this terrible fire in the early 80s?
Yeah, 1983, yeah.
At the risk of asking an obvious question, this is more than just, oh, I like jazz. This was part of who you are and were.
Yeah.
So that next day is, how do you put one foot in front of the other?
It was okay. You know, my record collection was a big blob of vinyl in my yard, but no one got hurt. You know, my infant son was there, and the lady that I was living with was there. So just, you know, a lot of things got destroyed, but no one got hurt. I replaced all of the music on CD and moved on. I like CDs better than I like vinyl. So.
Really?
Yeah, I do.
This is major, because I know a lot of music buffs who, I'm being quite serious, who kind of say the opposite.
No, I like CDs. It's clean. You put on, when you play vinyl, it sounds like somebody's frying an egg.
or has used it for a Frisbee.
Yeah.
Not that I would ever have done that, of course.
Well, with the covers, you could do that.
That's right.
The ones that you didn't like.
That's right. This may be a stretch here, but when you take the improvisation of jazz, can you draw a line between the improvisation of jazz and, for want of a better term, the improvisation that a five-person basketball team might have on the court and everybody's working in sync?
Oh, that's a very good analogy, because the whole idea of basketball and jazz being similar is very real. A jazz musician has to react to what the other guys are doing in time. So does the basketball player. The ball, which is kind of like the microphone that you get to solo on, that goes to certain people at certain times. All your timing and everything, you have to know when to do that and how to do it effectively and efficiently. The person who gets to shoot is the soloist. You got to set him up and make him look good. So it was really quite similar. And because, you know, they wanted me to shoot a lot, that was me. So I enjoyed that, you know.
Again, before we get to your questions, one of the other periods of your life that, and you wrote about it, coaching on the Native American on the reservation.
Yes.
That's pretty fascinating. I found that pretty fascinating. Where was it, and how did it come about?
It was on the White Mountain Apache Reservation. Fort Apache is on their reservation. The White Mountain Apaches were scouts for the U.S. Army, and because of that, their homeland was declared a federal reserve,
right.
And they were able to maintain possession of their homeland. So they're pretty proud of that. That's probably the only thing that the young men on the reservation can do and be proud of, is a lot of them still go into the military.
Mm-hmm.
But it was very interesting, because I never expected that all of the ills that you see in most inner cities are the same thing that you see there. Lack of good educational opportunities, substance abuse, teenage pregnancy, a lot of suicides, that poor nutrition, and you wouldn't expect that way the heck out in the Cocosino Mountains of Arizona, but
right.
There it is. It was very startling. Two of the kids that I coached, unfortunately, have committed suicide just because of the despair and just lack of self-esteem that is kind of endemic to their circumstances there.
Did you enjoy the coaching experience?
I did enjoy the coaching experience. I made some lifelong connections. I'm a member of the tribe. I'm an Apache Indian, right? But I'm a member of the tribe. I've been to the sunrise ceremony for a number of, I call them my nieces, just my friends' daughters. They have a special ceremony for girls when they're considered to be women, when they're about 14 or 15. And it's considered a privilege to take part in that. So I've done that. It was a very good experience for me. The whole idea of me going there was to try to encourage some of the kids to go to college. And the captain of the team, Kyle Goklisch, Mm-hmm. He is now the coach of the team.
Mm-hmm.
He's 30-something years old now. I've spoken to him on the phone, and he's doing a good job as coach. He ended up going to the University of Arizona on a cross-country scholarship, and he graduated, and I was very happy. But he was the only kid that that did that from the time that I was there.
You had some coaching periods. You did some work with big men in the NBA, and did some stuff with the Lakers. But the head coaching job never came. Is it something that still gnaws at you, or have you kind of made your peace with it?
It doesn't gnaw at me. You know, a lot of it has to do with politics. I was always very independent, and I think a lot of the people in the front offices did not feel that, you know, they didn't know if they could trust me, because I'm my independent streak might come up at a time that was inconvenient for them. So they more or less stayed away from me. But I've had a chance to work with a number of players. Joakim Noah of the Chicago Bulls came to me and wanted to learn how to improve his offensive game last summer. We spent about 12 or 15 days in the gym. Nice kid.
Yeah.
Really great attitude. He wanted to learn. He figured that he could benefit from the relationship, and it worked out that way. He had a great season last year. He just got hurt toward the end of the year and wasn't able to help his team in the playoffs. He was really disappointed.
But he's a tremendous defensive player, and there's, right. You know, everybody says, oh, he gave 100%, and it comes cliche. With him, there's no question about
No question. It was his offensive game that was a problem,
right.
And I was able to help him with that, and he learned. Great attitude.
Yeah. Let's get to some of your questions. I apologize in advance that we will not be able to get to all of them. Here we go. Do you think anyone will ever master the sky hook? Why not?
I don't know if anyone will master it. It's not that difficult, but you have to learn it. I learned it starting in the fifth grade. Somebody gave me a drill that George Mikan did. George Mikan was a great player who played for the original Minneapolis Lakers. He was 6'11", and really considered to be the first great big man in the game. And he had a drill where he shot the ball with either hand right in front of the basket. It teaches you ambidexterity and how to use the glass, and it works on your footwork. It's a really good drill.
Mm-hmm.
I just took that. I got my own ball, and I would just, every time I had a chance to get to a basket by myself, I'd work on that drill. And by the time I got into high school, the hook was there.
Hmm.
Everybody thinks that I learned the hook shot after they banned dunking while I was in college. But I had the hook shot going when I was in the seventh or eighth grade.
Surprised that more people don't use it?
Yeah, I am surprised. You can't block it. The guy guarding you can't block it if you know what you're doing. So. It's a great weapon, and it enabled me to get high percentage shots close to the basket and take a lot of them without taking a beating.
Mm-hmm.
That's why I was able to last 20 years.
Right.
But that message has not seemed to translate to another generation. So
perhaps because it won't get you on a highlight on ESPN.
Who knows?
Yeah. This is an interesting question. Up there with Sandy Koufax, not playing on Yom Kippur, was Kareem fasting on Ramadan and still playing? How does an athlete balance religious conviction with commitment to sport?
I did not fast during Ramadan because I just would not have the strength to play. My friend Hakeem Olajuwon did. The team made special considerations for him fasting during Ramadan, and he did that. He lost a lot of weight, though. I can't stand to lose any weight. I would disappear, literally, if I lost too much weight. So during Ramadan, I try to feed a family. That takes care of my my obligation. But I always felt that Islam gave me a very good moral anchor, and I tried to live up to it. I wasn't always an angel, but it really helped me figure out the difference between right and wrong, and it has helped me a lot in that sense.
Was the changing of your name a gradual process, a gradual decision, or is there a seminal moment where you decide, this is what I'm going to do?
I decided to become Muslim in 1968, and I didn't change my name for 4 years because I really wanted to test myself and see if that's what I wanted to do. So I took a number of years just to see if I was going to live it. And I tried to live it, and because of that, I did change my name. Mm-hmm.
Another question. What's the biggest challenge you faced as a human being, and how did you deal with the challenge?
Geez, the biggest challenge I faced as a human being was dealing with my family. You know, my children, I wasn't there that much when they were growing up, and I had to do some catch-up, and that was a challenge. I dealt with it as well as I could, but mm-hmm. They suffered a lot in certain ways mm-hmm. because I wasn't there. Of course, the money I made enabled me to support them in a style that enabled them to go to good schools and always have a roof over their head. But just the personal connection wasn't always there. And I was very happy when I retired that I was able to make up a lot of the lost ground. Not all of it, but a lot of it.
Right. How was your experience playing at Rucker Park? How would you compare the talent level there to the NBA?
Well, I'd say that Rucker Park was a very special part of life in Harlem. And the people in Harlem really were into it. The best part of that was when they played the Baker League from Philadelphia.
That's Earl Monroe territory.
Yes, it was. And it was very interesting. But I played one summer, and it was great just playing in front of the hometown audience. And
were you at UCLA or still at Power Memorial at the time?
It was the summer between when I finished at Power and started UCLA. Because once I started playing college ball, I couldn't play in the tournament.
I'd imagine UCLA was, don't turn any ankles when you're there. I always wondered about that when pro players went up there.
I was too far away. I was 3,000 miles away. There's nothing they could do until I got there. You know?
That's a good point. Yeah. That's a good point. This is great. Put you right on the spot. How many points did you score in your career? Perhaps the more interesting question is, who was your favorite player to play against?
In my career, my professional career, I scored 38,387 points. And the best challenge that I had playing professional basketball, probably the guys that made me work hardest would probably Nate Thurman and Bob Lanier.
Mm. Nate Thurman kind of gets lost in the shuffle in terms of talking about centers from that era.
Great defensive center, tall, agile, understood how to play defense. A lot of guys beat on me and said they played good defense. He actually did it. He made me earn my points.
I was going to mention it later on, but since we're here, did Lanier ever, you know, say thank you for, you know, mentioning him in one of the great lines in Airplane when you grabbed the kid?
Bob is still, he still resents a few things. Because, you know, his teams were never able, when he was with Detroit or Milwaukee, they were never able to beat the teams that I played on. And I always seemed to thwart him. The guys on his team would tell him, they always called him number two. And they said, all right, number two, you're getting ready to go against number one. And he hated that.
Shocking that he hated that.
No, plus I had, like, secret information about Bob. Bob liked to smoke cigarettes at halftime. So I knew that.
That's funny. At my basketball camp, they didn't include that as how to improve your game.
So I knew that Bob smoked cigarettes at halftime. So in the second half, I made Bob run, and you know he was in pain. I could see it, and it really affected his game. And he never knew that I knew that. I've talked to him about that since we've been retired, and he was like, "What?" He's like, "Geez, well, I should have known better."
Yeah. And yet you gave him the shout out in the line on Airplane.
Bob was a good dude, and plus he was president of the Players Association for a long time, and when I was representative for my team, I got to know him real well because we had to talk on the phone a lot.
Was there pressure against player reps in those days? What are you doing?
Especially before we got the good collective bargaining agreements. The back and forth between the owners and the Players Association could at times get very intense. Mm-hmm.
When you were an active player, did you discern regional styles of play? And if so, do you think they still exist? That's an interesting question.
Yeah, I think so. I noticed that coming from New York, guys from New York wanted to attack the hoop. Right. It's all about athletic ability, how high you could jump. A lot of guys from other parts of the country were better outside shooters. So there was a distinct regional thing. Guys from Detroit can play. I just noticed that a lot of guys from Detroit come in the league, they can play. They understand the game in Detroit. They play it very hard and they play it very well.
That's interesting. How would you compare playing with Oscar Robertson and playing with Magic Johnson?
I think there was a difference in style, but the content was the same. Both of those guys could run the offense and get points out of it. You could draw corkscrews on a chalkboard, and they could run a play and make something happen. I think Oscar was a little bit more complete in that he was a better outside shooter than Magic. But, you know, in terms of big guards, they are prototypical and really great leaders on top of being great athletes.
In my house growing up in the 60s, when I was becoming a sports fan, my father's a big sports fan, and there were certain just givens you just didn't argue about. That whole Mantle, Snyder, Mays, you know, who's the best, you know.
That was wonderful.
It was great, of course, but he just look at you and say, it's Willie. I mean, you look at you like, what are you talking about?
Right.
And I bring it up because in football, it's Jim Brown. Jim Brown, and there's everybody. And in basketball, it's the Big O.
It was Oscar. Oscar, so complete.
Yeah.
But you know, Duke Snyder hit a lot more home runs.
He was pretty, Oh, that's right, that Brooklyn thing, I forgot.
That's right.
Willie was pretty good.
Willie was awesome. I just saw Willie like 2 weeks ago.
Yeah.
Joe Torre had a charity dinner for his charity, so I was there, and Willie said, I got to sit next to Willie. It's always fun.
That's pretty good.
I saw Willie play his first year, 1951, because the lady that babysat for me used to live on St. Nicholas Place. We could walk to the polo grounds in about 10 minutes.
Right.
And after the third or fourth inning, you could get into the game for 50 cents.
Right.
So a lot of times, she'd take me. I don't remember any of this. I was 4 years old at the time. But I saw Willie play his first year, and I saw it, and that was also Mickey Mantle's first year, and Joe DiMaggio's last year, and I saw them all play that year.
It's pretty good.
It was.
It's pretty good.
I wish I could remember it.
Yeah, well. looking back, is there or are there anything, or in plural, other things you would have done differently?
There are always little things that you think that you could have done differently, but I've had an incredibly blessed life. I'm not going to complain about, you know, we didn't win two more championships and stuff like that. You know, I'll take it as it was. It was an incredible ride, and it's still happening. I'm very fortunate to be alive. I'm surviving leukemia, and that to me is enough right there.
Your health's good?
My health is great.
Great.
Yeah.
That's great to hear. Great to hear. You mentioned all the championships. It's funny. I'm along with being a big basketball fan, a big hockey fan, and there's a story in the hockey world that if a former player, or certainly a current player, has not won the Stanley Cup, this legendary trophy, that they won't even be in the same room with it. If it comes to your town during the summer, and somebody else in the town, in Ontario, let's say, has won the Stanley Cup, and they have it in town, the people who have not won it don't touch it. They just want to get away from it. When you're dealing with former players who you played with, who did not win a championship, does it ever come up, or is there some kind of unspoken, if you know, you won all those championships, you were on a great team, you were one of the greatest players of all time, is there kind of a sadness about it for former players who never won a championship?
I don't think so. Basketball has, to me, been a brotherhood. It started, as I mentioned earlier, when I was 13 years old and went to Madison Square Garden, and Willie Nauls and Richie Guerin kind of took me under their wing. And, you know, I was like a little brother to them. And that goes on from generation to generation. And there's no resentment. You know, there's no resentment there. I don't see it. All the guys that I played against and had intense rivalries with, we're friends now. Right. Even Bill Walton, you know. But Bill and I didn't speak for about two or three years after he retired. then after I retired, he said, what was that all about? We buried the hatchet and we're friends. But while it's going on, you don't like them. You want to beat them. I wanted to beat Larry Bird. I wanted to beat all those guys. But when it's all over, you have nothing but respect for them because you know that they went through the same things that you did to develop and perfect their game and the effort that it took to make it into the NBA and distinguish yourself. And you really appreciate that a lot more than you remember the rivalry and right. and the competition.
This is a rather concise question. Do you miss Dyckman Street?
Dyckman Street has changed. You have to speak Spanish to go shopping on Dyckman Street now. That's part of the New York story. So, I was coaching a minor league team, and we played in Brooklyn. This is in 2002. And we also played a game upstate New York. So we came down the thruway, and I said, let me stop on Dyckman Street. It was Sunday morning. It was early. So I went and bought the New York Times on at the store that I always bought it at when I was a kid. I just stood out there for about a half hour. And it's so different. All the stores are different ethnicity. Most of the people there are from Santo Domingo now. Mm-hmm. And it's totally changed the whole complexion of the neighborhood. My daughter lives up there now. It's amazing. She's living up there. But it was so interesting to me just to go back. The real estate's the same, but everything else has changed.
Different world.
I guess that's New York.
This journey has taken you all over the world.
Yes, it has.
Obviously, California's been your home for a long time, but just even telling stories about being on the reservation and that coaching experience there, and I would imagine travel around the world. Is there a part of you that you can say, because I grew up in New York, because I grew up in Harlem and in Inwood, that is at the core of who I am, and even though I may be geographically and in some sense, in other ways, far away from that place, it's still pretty much inside.
I think growing up, you understand that New York is a city of immigrants.
Right.
My family immigrated here from the West Indies. My grandfather came and lived in Brooklyn in 1917. I have a lot of cousins in Brooklyn now. And so I always saw myself as part of that. So I go to the movies and see Gangs of New York. I get it. Yeah.
That's funny. A couple of questions about the book. In your book, Sasquatch in the Paint, is your reference B.I.B., because I'm black, in the book, taken from your adolescence? Can you explain that? For people who haven't read the book yet.
B.I.B. has got to be from the generation of people who text. When I was a kid, we would write things on a piece of paper and leave them. And that was it. And it's funny, I was talking to somebody, and I said, just recently, I said, when we were kids, you wanted to connect with your friends, you'd see them at the park, and you'd go to the park. Nowadays, when kids want to hook up with their friends, they go online.
Right.
The world's changed a lot.
Is Brian in the book, Brian, I'm just trying to figure out how the question is situated. Is Brian in the book still a friend of yours? The character Brian in the book.
Oh, that character's not like a real person based on anybody that I know.
Got it, okay. Yeah. We answered that. Dear Kareem, could you speak about your thoughts on the continued closing of New York City Catholic High School Association, Athletic Association schools such as Rice and Power Memorial?
I think it's very unfortunate. The Catholic school system here was such a great system. I don't know what's happening. In fact, my grade school is going to close. I've heard from them. They wanted to know if I could help. St. Jude's Grade School on 204th Street in Inwood.
What year did Power close?
Power closed in 1984 because the building right. was not up to fire code. And it's right there in Lincoln Center.
Right.
So they sold it and made a lot of money. I don't know what they did with the money, but they closed the school down. And I guess Rice just closed last year or the year before last.
So Power closed. Your elementary school is about to close?
Yes.
How's your middle school doing?
I didn't go to middle school. I went to grade school to grade eight and then started high school as a freshman. Yeah.
All right. We have to close. All right. Two more questions.
Okay.
We'll try and do one funny and one perhaps lofty and poetic. How did airplane come about? That's the lofty and poetic one, by the way.
The Zucker brothers are from Whitefish Bay, Wisconsin. They saw me play when I played for the Bucks. They always thought it would be neat if they could do a funny movie that featured me doing jokes about my basketball career. So when they had a movie called Kentucky Pride Movie that was a big success, and they got a chance to do Airplane, and they contacted me and wanted me to act in it. And I had dabbled in acting. I thought it would be fun and a challenge to do some serious acting. And that's how that came about.
This movie is beloved.
Do
you have a sense of that? Or
flying up here, I was in D.C. and sitting in the airport in D.C., some pilots were sitting near me, and they started talking to me about the lines in Airplane. I think everybody in the airline industry watches that movie at some point in their life. I was in
Europe. But were they flying the plane at the time?
No. This is while I was waiting for my flight. But I was in Europe flying, where was I flying? I was flying from London to Rome. And this is on Lufthansa, and it was on one of those really big jets that has extra seats in the cockpit. Mm-hmm. So we're getting ready to taxi out. We had pulled away from the gate and taxiing out. And the pilot comes out from the cockpit and says, hey, you, come here. I'm like, me? He said, yeah, come here. I'm like, what? So I unhooked my belt. He said, no, come with me. He took me into the cockpit. They strapped me in. They said, no, sit here. You're going to sit here for takeoff. So, we take off. And they said, thanks. We want to be able to tell everybody that we flew with Murdoch.
I can't top that. I think when we watch the games that we love, my father always taught me, admire what they do, or he didn't even have to say it, admire what they do on the field of play, be it the ice or the gridiron or the court or the baseball diamond. And if along the way these people turn out to be, as we would say in our house, mensches, if they turn out to be people of substance who realize that there's a world beyond that field of play, well, that's just great. And so I've always admired the athletes and former athletes who gave it all they had, but also, as I mentioned earlier, realized that there was a big world out there. And you have shown that through the books, also through the documentary. And this book is a terrific read, especially not just for young readers either. Sasquatch in the Paint. Welcome back to New York.
Thank you very much.